Hi everyone, I'm Miranda and welcome to my YouTube channel. Today I'm excited to say that my mum Donna has joined me.
Hello.
And we're going to discuss Affinity by Sarah Waters for the October book club. This is just the second book club we've done. And I've been really looking forward to it. I chose Affinity because I thought it would be a great read for October and Halloween month. It's definitely got a ghostly sort of quality to it.
It was a great choice.
Yes, thank you. Yes. And the plot has some twists and turns. I enjoyed the story overall. I was really impressed that this was only Sarah Waters' second novel.
Yes.
But we'll talk about it thoroughly today. I do want to warn people that spoilers are very likely to crop up in our conversation.
I don't think I'll be able to stop myself perhaps saying something.
Yes, and it's a difficult book to discuss without giving spoilers, and we want to talk about it properly. So if you don't want the plot spoilt for you, then don't watch this until you've read the book. Read it first, and then you can come back and watch this video. But I know some of you have been reading along with us, which is great. So you can put your thoughts about the book in the comments down below. We'd love to read them.
We would.
Yes. But anyway, as I was saying, this is only Sarah Waters' second novel. And I thought, as only a second book, it was very strong.
She's really a super writer. This is what I felt. Yes.
Yeah.
Yes.
I think she's really talented, and she captured the setting of Millbank Prison well.
And 1870s London, and I thought it was amazing.
Yes,
yeah.
I loved the slightly gothic Victorian quality to the book.
Definitely.
I think she did that really well. And the prison scenes to me were, I don't know, almost a bit surreal. Like, they had this dreamlike quality to them.
They really
did. Nightmarish.
A terrible place, wasn't it?
Yeah, really
and
terrible.
And so creepy.
Yes, and it was a real place, too, a real prison.
Yeah.
And I think
she really researched it because she didn't exaggerate how awful it was. In fact, it was closed by the most, you know, by the way it had such terrible death rates and things.
Yeah. Well, and haven't they built Tate Britain?
Yes,
on that
Tate
old
Britain.
Site?
And apparently there's an old bollard. I wish we'd known this when we lived in London. We could have actually gone and looked. But yes, fascinating.
I know. When we go back to London,
definitely,
I will see Tate Britain with fresh eyes.
Yes.
Because it's quite creepy to think it's on the site of this old prison. And the beginning, I thought, was very strong, where Margaret Pryor turns up at the prison and she describes these pentagons. It almost looks like a flower with petals somehow. The map of the building, I looked it up so I could actually kind of picture what it would look like.
It's like a maze, isn't it? She says, they're so proud of never losing their way, the wardens. But then it's quite clear that it's still like a maze for anybody who's not initiated.
Yes, and even after she's been visiting the prison for months, she finds new, rather horrific rooms that she's never discovered before, never been shown before.
Yes.
And I thought that was really well done. I wanted to read one of my favourite scenes from the book, because partly why I thought this book was such a good choice for October is I thought she writes very atmospherically about the autumn. This is mainly set in October and November.
Yes.
And she writes about the fogs of London.
Very Dickensian too, the way she does it, isn't it?
Yes, it has a real Dickensian feel to it. So I thought I'd read aloud an extract about that. 23rd October, 1874. It has grown colder this week. The winter has come early, as it came early in the year that Pa died, and I've begun to see the city change again, as I watched it changing in the miserable weeks when he lay ill. The hawkers on the walk now stand and stamp their ragged booted feet, cursing the cold. and where the horses wait, you see knots of children huddling at the side of the beast's great wet flanks for the sake of their heat. There was a mother and her three sons found starved and frozen to death, Ellis told me, in a street across the river from here 2 nights ago. And Arthur says that when he drives along the Strand in the hours before dawn, he sees beggars crouched in doorways with their blankets rimed with frost. There have come fogs too, yellow fogs and brown fogs, and fogs so black they might be liquid soot. Fogs that seem to rise from the pavements as if brewed in the sewers in diabolical engines. They stain our clothes, they fill our lungs and make us cough. They press against our windows. If you watch in a certain light, you may see them seeping into the house through the ill-fitting sashes. We are driven into the darkness now. At 3 or 4 o'clock, and when Vigers lights the lamps and the flames are choked and burn quite dim.
Wow.
And she goes on saying, my own lamp is burning very dimly now. And I did light an oil lamp in honour of it, but it's burnt so dim it's gone out. But I tried.
Well, the atmosphere was there.
Yes, exactly.
Yeah.
But what did you think of it? I know at the beginning you were a bit unsure as to like what was going on.
I was.
It took you a while to adjust to the dual narrative structure.
Yes, I think so. But once I did, I really enjoyed it. I felt it was slow to start, but it really gathered momentum. And by the end, it became a real page turner.
Yeah.
Once you sort of go, it's one of those books you finish and you flick to the front and you realise all the clues are there for you.
Yes.
You've got to just sort of see it once you get to the end. But I was fascinated. I think she's so good at character as well as setting the scene as she did. The settings were so good. But I thought character too, because I found like you have somebody in Margaret Pryor who's almost, incredibly naive. She's also being obviously like kept quite drugged by her mother.
That's shocking.
I mean, that's very shocking.
The amount of like laudanum and other drugs that she's taken. So it really clouds her own ability, I think, to maybe work out what's going on too.
That's
especially
what
by the end. Her own ability to understand things and take care of herself is really impeded.
And I felt the tragedy of the ending, because I think it's very much a tragedy at the end.
Yes, it is. And I felt so sorry for Margaret, actually.
So did
she's
I.
I don't think she's a very likeable character. I couldn't like her a great deal.
She was completely, didn't you feel too, like she had no sense of her own self. Like she was happy helping her father. She was happy in her relationship with Helen, her to-be sister-in-law.
Yeah.
She reacted to her mother. She latched on to Selena Dawes.
Yeah.
But in fact, she was completely unself-aware and really unaware of her world. Like she never even bothered to find out about the servants, what their first name would be. She had no sense of where her money was coming from and what she actually had.
Yeah.
She really was someone that only wanted everything in correlation with other people helping her. So she wanted to go to Italy, but first it was the dream for her to go with her father and Helen.
Yes.
And then it was, she wanted to go with Selena. But there wasn't any serious sense that she would take charge of her own life.
No, she didn't have much agency.
Gumption.
Did she?
No.
Whether that was the drug-induced state.
But then she was obviously suicidal. The mother was obviously to extent. I didn't like the mother at all, but perhaps she was also hoping to stop her from trying to suicide again. I mean,
she was obviously depressed after the death of her father. And the way that was treated was just to give her drugs, essentially, which she becomes more and more addicted to.
Mm-hmm.
As the book continues,
so that she's increasing dosages and types of drugs as well, isn't it? It changes.
Yes,
I think
it does.
Yeah,
and I thought that she, as much as Selena is in a sort of prison.
Yeah.
And sadly, one that was partly through society.
Yes.
But it was also partly through her own making.
Yes.
Like you said, it was so sad to me that in fact she would have had the means. She was independently wealthy. Yes. She could have struck away from her mother and found a companion, even a companion,
yes.
Or found a friend to go to this longed for trip to Italy by herself and actually live a little.
Her life. Yes.
She had no sort of life, and the part of herself that comes alive in the story is through her diary.
Exactly. That's fascinating, because it is that really brings her to life. In some ways, all of the yes. women are almost voiceless, and it's their writing.
Yes.
There's a big thing in there about being choked, about not having a voice.
Yes.
And I think Sarah Walters is really showing
what
it's
like
for women.
And the women in the prison, in fact, are not allowed to speak at all.
I think that was shocking to me. I had no idea.
I had
no idea that was true either,
that they had, even in their sort of walks outside in the sort of prison courtyard,
yes.
they still weren't allowed to speak at all. And I that was really shocking to me as well. And all of these rules of the prison, you could compare to the rules of society
exactly.
that also restricted women and made them voiceless.
Yeah.
However, there are some women in this book who flout all rules
yes, they
of
do.
Society.
They certainly
and
do.
And they don't maybe have a very moral outlook.
No, but they have a voice, all right. They state what they
yes.
want. They go ahead, don't
yes,
they?
Yes, they do. And they certainly twist circumstances to suit themselves. What did you think of Selena's character?
I thought that she was someone rather like, at first, before she visits Selena in the cell, she visits a neighbour of hers who comes from a thieving family. And she's amazed by the loyalty amongst thieves and the way they work together and the honesty of this person, the straightforwardness, that this is what I do. When I get out, I'm going to just try and do it better so I'm not caught. And I felt that she listened to that, took it in, but then went to Selena and only saw her appearance, this angelic, beautiful young woman. Whereas it's quite clear that Selena also comes from a sort of family of frauds. She's been, coached to be a medium, to deal in this. She realizes, and this is so interesting in the diary, she always is saying to her clients, oh, I never take money. But in the diary, it's always marked down exactly how much
yes.
was paid. Like
yeah.
she obviously money, she understands. She's comes from a very poor background. She's careful with the men. She understands that men actually can use her and completely ruin her. But on the other hand, she's very much a creature of Ruth, isn't she? I got the
yes.
feeling that Ruth was the controlling force, the
yes.
older woman, the one who helped her. She was someone in some ways who had some innocence as well.
Yes, I thought that Ruth was really the controlling force behind Selena as well. And it's interesting because I think that this book is a good example of an unreliable narrator.
It really is.
And Selena to me is much more intentionally deceptive in the parts of the narration that you get in the book that are seen through her perspective. There's definitely things that are withheld from the reader, whereas Margaret is unintentionally misdirected.
Yes.
Which I thought was interesting, but at the same time, you never get a real hold on what Selena really feels about all of this. How much is she dominated and controlled by Ruth? Did she have any pity for Margaret?
I felt no, did you?
Yeah, I thought that
yes.
was most likely that she didn't. And she and Ruth were very much in it together. Did you see the twist coming?
I did.
Yes.
I did.
So did
you?
Did I.
Yes.
Yes. The minute the servant is changed.
I think that
I think it's because I've read so many mysteries. It's like that is suspicious. Yeah.
So that's she was how they did take it. Less money.
Yeah. That's another red giveaway, isn't
yes,
it?
Yes, it is.
Yes. But it's interesting that they were able to play that trick partly because of Margaret's status and class. I thought the element of class was very interesting in the way she discussed it in the book. Margaret is not aware, barely at all, of her servants. She can't even really remember what they look like. And she's so lost in her own world. And then again, there's also the point between, although yes, Margaret feels imprisoned by her life, some of that is, like we said, just through her own making. I mean, yes, it's also societal rules that women have to adhere to.
The dragon of a mother, too.
Yes, exactly. But she could have fought to have a bit more independence than she did. And also, class is so important in terms of whether, as a woman, you would be likely to be sent to prison or not. And that Margaret realizes that because she attempts suicide at a point prior to when the book begins, because she was of a certain social caste, she was in no danger of being sent to prison. But actually, that was a criminal offense. And she meets women in the prison who were there because they tried to take their own lives under horrific circumstances.
Yes, that's very well done, isn't it?
Yeah, so I thought that was a really interesting point to the book as well. But the whole atmosphere, I also thought, was brilliant. I loved all those descriptions.
It was amazing, and everything was so colourless.
Yes, that's such a good point.
It was. Yeah. It wasn't only that the women were actually silent. There was also so little colour, not only in the prison for the women, obviously, but actually Margaret's choice was to live a very drab, colourless life.
Yeah.
And I wanted to read, she goes to visit the women in the prison and is very surprised how one of the women is, you know, rather critical of what she's dressed. She's like, but you're free. Why aren't you wearing bright colours and looking cheerful? And the woman says to her, I would have a gown of chambray gauze and a cloak of otter and a hat of straw with lilies on it. And for her feet, silk slippers with ribbons to the knee. But that, I protested gently, was a costume for a party or a ball. She wouldn't wear such a costume there, would she? To Millbank. Wouldn't she? Oh, just wouldn't she? And you think, yes, like she's very much making herself fit her sort of depression in even the way she dresses, Margaret.
Yes, it's true. It's a real sign of her depression and perhaps her assuming this role of the spinster aunt.
Exactly. She really latches onto it very bitterly, but she does. Yeah. But then it's interesting when she finally can express her love for Selina, and she decides to buy clothes for their escape together for Selina. And what does she get? She gets a gown of pearl grey cashmere with an underskirt of some thick kind of greenish silk. The green, I thought, will match her eyes. The cashmere will be warm enough for an Italian winter. I bought both dresses and then another, a dress of white with velvet trim and a narrow, narrow waist. It is a dress to bring out all the girlishness they have subdued at Millbank. I bought her petticoats and also stays and also chemises and stockings of black. And since stockings will be useless without shoes, I bought her shoes, black shoes and buff coloured shoes and slippers of white velvet to match the girlish dress. And I thought it's quite astounding. She sits and waits for Selina to come, supposedly by being transported by spirits through the air. But she's sitting surrounded by these sumptuous, soft and luscious
very feminine, very sensual
garments. And then when she doesn't come, what she says is, soon I will pack them back in their wrapping paper. At that point, she's assuming she's just been held up in some way.
Yes.
But it's like a putting away again.
Yes, and it's so sad in a way that she felt somehow that she should be denied these pleasures, or she was somehow undeserving of wearing beautiful clothes herself.
Exactly. Her sister was the beauty, we're told, and she was always told how plain she was. She was the one that helped her father with his research.
Yes. And she seemed to almost want to assume that blue stocking kind of role. But in fact, through the story, what you feel about Margaret is she's so desperate to love and to be loved. And I mean, that love is always going to be doomed, really, in a novel of this time, because she loves other women. Mm-hmm. But it's not only a kind that she wants to love, she also does have a real yearning for colour and for life. She describes at one point, beauty. She describes at one point to Selena why she wants to go to Italy. Mm-hmm. And it's this really touching moment in the book, because she sort of pours her heart out and says how much she's yearning for the sunshine and for light and for orange blossom.
Yes.
And the scent of it, and seeing all these colours, enjoying all of these senses. You know, in London, she's almost literally suffocating through this poisonous fog that comes in and encloses her. And she yearns for freedom and for beauty and sunlight. And in fact, the cake we've decided to make in honour of Affinity for our book club is an orange Madeira cake with orange blossom icing.
Yes, using orange flower water.
Orange blossom flower water, yes, exactly. Yeah. Because we thought that would be rather an appropriate choice. The food is generally dire.
Oh, terrible. Yes. It really is stodgy. Most of it's congealed, whether you're in the aristocracy of Margaret's life or in the prison. I mean, it's...
Yes, and by the end, Margaret is essentially not eating at all, is she?
No.
And is only on drugs. And for the most part, when the women sort of do eat, they tend to ask for a glass of wine. They always end up reviving through wine, or they eat little white bits of meat.
Chicken or something. Yes,
exactly. Yes. So I thought a Madeira cake would go with wine.
Yes.
As they always seem to be needing a glass of restorative wine in this book. But the orange blossom icing was your idea, and I thought that was fantastic.
Well, it gives a bit of colour to what was really the most incredibly drab. I mean, even when you think about it, what she sends her, the velvet collar.
Yes.
Again, like the collar, but it was velvet. So, things like that, the orange blossoms, her hair, which is described so...
like gold. Yes, exactly.
And scents, I think she's sent by. She never seems to ask very clearly where all these things are coming from. It's always believed it's the spirits that have somehow...
Yes. How do you think her infatuation for Selena started? I mean, I thought it was partly to do with the fact that Selena clearly reminds her of Helen.
Yes.
Yet they both have the golden hair.
She's her type, I would
guess. Yes, I suppose that must be it. And she really does become just completely infatuated, if not obsessed by her, without knowing much about her.
No, and she makes the mistake at one point, do you remember, where she quotes something like St. Agnes Eve to her?
Yes.
And then is surprised and a little bit disappointed that Selena doesn't know the poetry, doesn't know the story, and then realises, oh no, she wouldn't, but that will come. In a way, she wants to shape Selena.
Yes. Yeah, that's very true. Yeah. Or she's using Selena as a sort of substitute for Helen, with whom she obviously did have this both an intellectual and emotional connection to.
Yeah.
Which I found interesting. And I thought that was very sad too, that part of the
She
book.
Was so repressed, Margaret, wasn't she?
She was,
too?
Yes.
She was just ready and ripe to burst out again. You could just feel that. And in some ways, I think that Selena obviously was crafty enough and clever enough to play her. Mm.
And not just her either. I mean, she is a real con woman,
yes.
Selena, you realise. And I thought that was quite fun in a way too, though I felt terribly for Margaret.
Oh, and it is for Mrs. Jelf, is it Mrs. Jelf?
Yes, exactly, yes. For both of them. Selena fools both of them. But I don't know, in some ways you also can't help admiring her a little bit.
No, it's that she's got vigour. They're going to go off to the sunshine.
Yeah.
And you realise the very first time Italy is mentioned is right at the beginning, and it's Ruth that says, I've always wanted to send you to Italy or France or Spain or something. She said, because abroad.
Mm.
Yes, think of all the white ladies that are ripe for the plucking there. Like, she's there, definitely.
Yes, I think that was really well done. And like you said, maybe throughout the novel, you're not quite sure how guilty Selena is. But
by the end,
for sure. But like you said, there are these hints through the diary of how she carefully marks down how much money she's earned from each seance.
But then on the other hand, you do sympathise, don't you? Because how could she live without doing this? Yeah. I mean, it was prostitution probably for a woman like herself or a servant.
Yes, yes. Yeah, that's very true. And I mean, in some ways, you don't quite know with Selena. You think, did she feel that she was still bringing people some happiness, or does she not care at all? You never quite understand her, do you?
You don't. And certainly she was with Mrs. Brink at one point. She's saying, she was crying, but she could wait, was the way it comes, you know.
Yes, yes. You feel that there is really hardness there, I think, in the end. But I agree. I thought that the story started out a bit slowly with the pace, but I felt that it gained a lot of momentum. And then by the end, I was really gripped, and I had to keep going. It has a sad ending.
It does. I think it's. I mean, would you say? I think she almost certainly kills herself.
Yes, that's how I read it. Yeah. Yes, I don't know if anyone else. What you think about the ending? I think that she is going to take an overdose. You thought maybe she was going to go into the river.
I did. I thought there were some clues about maybe she would drown herself this time. But of course, she was alone. She could take an overdose.
Yeah, and not be found in time.
And even at the end, she makes this mistake to me of thinking, but you know, Helen will get my letter and wonder about it. And in the end, you think, but it was actually Ruth who delivered the letter. So it's very unlikely to me that she would ever really have delivered a letter without reading it first and deciding.
Yes.
So what did you think would be a great book to read after this, maybe for other people to choose?
Well, what I wanted to recommend was The Corset by Laura Purcell. You've read this one too, because I recommended it to
you. Yes, you did, and it was brilliant too.
Yeah, it's really good, and it's similar to Affinity in that there's the dual narrative structure. One of the women is in prison and is visited by a woman of a much higher social class. But it's a really, really gripping page turner of a book, and I really recommend it.
It moves faster, doesn't it, this one?
It moves faster than Affinity, for sure, yes.
And then for me, I thought I wanted to recommend a Persephone, The Victorian Chaiselongue by, do you say Marganita?
Marganita
Lasky.
Yes.
I love this. It's a horror story. To me, it's even more horrific.
More of a psychological. It's not really horror, but
no, not really horror, but it's actually a horrible tale to me.
It is,
And because actually, she says in here, I think there's a point that can be made about the whole Affinity thing too, is there's this line where she says something like, she says, sin, you know, changes like fashion. And you think, yes, like this book was very much of its period.
Mm-hmm.
And this is about where someone travels back in time and becomes locked into an earlier time.
Yeah, she travels back to the Victorian age, doesn't she? Yes. Like the 1930s.
Yes, I think. And she can't, just by sitting on this Victorian chaise.
And she can't leave the chaise.
No, it's creepy.
It is really creepy. It's a good Halloween read, actually, too.
Yes.
And yes, I think that would be a good one to read alongside Affinity. Because it's about a type of prison.
It is.
Again.
Yes, she's imprisoned in the place and the time. And the real horror to her comes when she realizes that it's not a dream, it's happening.
Yes.
Yeah.
Yes. No, I know, but it's such a slim book. I think that's a great recommendation. I would really recommend it too. I'm looking forward to cutting into this cake.
Oh, super. I wanted
to also share with you the choice for next month. So November's book club choice is going to be The Return of the Soldier by Rebecca West.
And yet again, we dithered a bit, didn't we?
I really thought so hard over what the choice should be. And I did really want to do The Testament of Youth.
Yeah.
But, well, you thought it would be too long.
So long.
Yes. And it is a really big book. And what with Christmas coming and, you know, this is such a busy time of year that at least for this year, maybe not The Testament of Youth.
Plus, I've never read this and I've always wanted to.
Yes. And we have both read The Testament of Youth already. I want to reread it, but I can do that myself. But I'm really excited to try this one. It's meant to be a really good book. It's very slim, so even if you're busy, and I know that this is a crazy time of year, isn't it? So we thought that a nice slim book would be a good choice, but it's meant to be brilliant. It's set just after World War One, when a man returns. I think he returns to the three women in his life who are something like his sister, his wife, and his ex-girlfriend, or something like that. Yes.
Yeah.
And it's meant to be really good. So I'm looking forward to this.
Read along with us, please.
Yes, do read with us if you would like to. I'll link to the books mentioned in the description box down below. But do let us know what you thought of Affinity.
Yes.
What were your thoughts on it? How did you find the pace? Did you find the first half a bit slow like we did? Mm-hmm. What did you think of Margaret?
Selena,
did the twists and turns surprise you? I'd really like to know. But anyway, I think we're going to cut into this cake now.
Cake time.
So we'll say goodbye.
Thank you.
Thanks so much for watching. And we'll be back on Friday for a tea reads.
Exactly.
Yes, when we bake and talk about books on camera.
It's your turn to bake this time.
It is, yes. So I've got to decide what I'm going to do. But give this video a thumbs up if you enjoyed it. Don't forget to subscribe to my channel, which you can do by clicking my face. It pops up on the screen. And join in the November book club chat. We'll look forward to it then.
That's right.
Bye-bye. Bye-bye.